Blam, blat, splat. As by now most of the civilized world knows, this is Luke Skywalker's speeder. This is Luke Skywalker, and that's Obi-Ben Kenobi, and we're surrounded by three stormtroopers, and we're sitting in some of the gear belonging to the world's biggest grossing movie ever, Star Wars. After costing $9.5 million, it has grossed over $200 million in the United States. Beneath those grave and reverend features up there, you will perhaps recognize the outlines of Sir Alec Guinness, and you may not quite so readily recognize the outlines of Mr. Mark Hamill, whose replica is sitting next to me. I'm going to talk to the real Mark Hamill in a few minutes.
For the first time in cinema history, set and costumes from a screen spectacular have become museum pieces even before the first showing. London Science Museum, youngsters of every age are drawn to this cavalcade of way-out stars. Actors include Alec Guinness as Ben Kenobi and Peter Cushing. Mark Hamill plays Luke Skywalker in the £6 million epic.
Be very much sort of the classic fairy tale or myth that was the King Arthur story, or even back to Homer and the Odyssey stories, the young man who sets off on some sort of great adventure. That's the daydream really of every 10 or 11 year old. No matter what era they grow up in. And it's been manifest in literature for a long, long time, and in film also, in the American Western, and films about the Middle Ages, the Robin Hood type movies, Prince Valiant, even some war movies have the same basic appeal.
Kids go crazy
when they see the screen. I'm close in age to them, just on the bridge of being from teenager to young adulthood, and they see me triumph over evil, and they think I could do that. I mean, it's a strong identification thing. And with in the princess's case, rather than a damsel in distress, she's right there with the boys shooting the laser guns. Girls love that because they know if they were being chased by the baddies, they'd shoot back just like we would. I imagined very close to the way they finally cast 3PO, and his dialogue, his fussiness, his preciseness, you know. At one point in the film, he says, "I've forgotten how much I hate space travel." He'd be much more at home serving hors d'oeuvres and discussing opera with a sophisticated crowd. Now, this guy, R2-D2, was dubbed later, so if he had a line or something, we would react to it as if he said it, and they'd put it in later. That was the only stretch. Other than that, our 3PO was played by Anthony Daniels, and I could hear him, muffled, mind you, but I could hear him. And it was strange, as the movie progressed, even though he has an expressionless face, I could see expressions, anger, fear. I mean, he was very real to me. It was kind of a shock when they'd take his head off and there was a human being inside.
Especially an Englishman.
He's our mechanical Hudson, you see.
He's really based very much on the robot in Fritz Lang's Metropolis.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yes.
But the one in Metropolis only walked forward 3 paces, and George tells me that they wanted it to do a lot more, and it couldn't, and they had to compromise. It was George's idea that it should be like the robot from Metropolis. I mean, every frame in the movie is very much George's. I mean, you know, he's makes a big contribution to the whole, every aspect of the movie, really.
And did you find all the time, Mark, that when you were acting with were there always people in the robots that you were talking to, or sometimes were you just using the duplicates?
Sometimes we were using the radio control robots.
Yes.
You could never tell. There would be 5 or 6 R2-D2s, and everyone would break for lunch. You'd hear a little voice going, "Let me out! Let me out!" And then everybody was betting £2 on which R2-D2 he's in. Get his head off. Okay, you win.
We think this is one of the ones which was a duplicate. It was not the one that Kenny Baker
well, this is one of the ones that Kenny was in, actually.
Is it?
Yes, there were 8 or 9 different ones. They all did different things because of the technical requirements of the script.
And they were terribly heavy, I believe, to
well, this is one of the ones made out of metal. There were 2 or 3 of them were made out of fiberglass, which are a little easier for him to deal with.
did you have any malfunctions with the real equipment, apart from the actors?
the robots. Well, that was one of the things that actually made them so endearing, was that they started doing things that, just like real actors will do, screwing up occasionally. R2 would stop functioning sometimes completely. The radio control wouldn't function in the radio control version, or he would fall over. Or a couple of times out in the desert, he ran into 3PO and knocked him down.
Didn't in Africa, they were running him on radio control, and we started picking up Arabic pop stations, which freaked him out completely.
Throw the radio control off, and sometimes he would start up in the middle of a scene when he wasn't supposed to. So it was rather bizarre, actually, but it was a lot of fun. Everybody got to really like them all because of that. That was one of the things that
I noticed you talk about them as if they were real characters.
Yes, they are. They sort of became real characters to us, always.
Did you find yourself actually unconsciously behaving tenderly towards them, or affectionately?
Yes. Oh, yes. Yes, definitely.
There's a portion in the film where R2 is ambushed and he falls face down into the dirt. And every audience I've seen it with goes, oh, like when Lassie got wounded or something.
Yes.
He's like a mechanical teddy bear. Everybody wants to hold and squeeze him.
Yes.
Cuddle him.